or whatever the theme song is for that. It's an extra spooky time of the year. That's right, everybody knows that the depths of April are the spookiest-ish time of the year. Or maybe it's May. I don't know when I'm uploading this. It might be August. I might forget to upload it. That's happened before. Hey, I'm doing a new show. Well, kind of new. It's Noob Reviews, but, not Noob Reviews. Yeah, I'm reviewing every Hellboy canon book ever. And maybe a few, like, non-canon books. There are a few Hellboy books that aren't canon. But mainly, I'm going to review every Hellboy book, canon book ever. Because if you follow me on Twitter, you'd know that I started on a mission. Because I am a warrior! And he likes to sit down and read comic books. So yeah, today you can see my background. I got Witchfinder, Lost and Gone Forever, the variant of it. Because I went to my comic book store to find specifically that variant. And it was the only issue of Witchfinder they even had ever. So, I got insanely lucky with that. And I got that new hardcover of Hellboy Into the Silent Sea right there. Brand new, only a few weeks old. Of course, the most famous Mike Mignola property. I got Champions, written by Mark Wade Nola. I didn't have anything like colorful to put in the back, so I put that back there. Instead, my bland-ass BCW box. That, you know, sponsor me, please. And I also got my trades here. I got a very, like, weirdly incomplete, like, I have many single issues of, Mignola-Versed stuff, but I don't have many trades, and I have, like, a weird selection, because I this starts at volume 3 of Lobster Johnson. I have every trade of Witchfinder, which I specifically went on my way to get, because, spoiler alert, I really fucking like Witchfinder. I have this random trade, volume 6 of BPRD Hell on Earth. Because I was like, I've been reading it online, but I needed a physical thing to read for a little while. And I was just like, you know what, I'll get this. And actually, it's one of my favorite volumes of it. So that wasn't by choice. I just happened to pick up one of my favorite volumes. So I'm very happy I did. I also have Hellboy and the BPRD right here, which is a phenomenal prequel series that's both a prequel to BPRD and Hellboy. And I also have volume 11 of Hellboy, which... this is the very first comic book I ever bought, honestly. And someday I'll review it. It's really fucking good. It's just like a collection of stories. Although, to be fair, I did that same day buy 2 single issues from this trade. Because I wasn't really sure how that worked. But yeah, good stuff. So, let's see. I got a little list of things I gotta go over. Okay, cool. So, all right. So, first off, one thing I'm going to do before every one of these is I'm going to display my current progress in reading all these books so you know how far in I am. So, here we go. Wasn't that spectacular? Alright, what's today's book? Well, I decided to start on one of my favorite books, one of my favorite books in all of the Mignola stuff that I've read. Because I was really taken off guard with this book. I really like it. And that is Witchfinder, Volume 1, in the Service of Angels. Or if you're a twat, you can pronounce it Sir Edward Grey Witchfinder in the Service of Angels. Because everybody does that, and I'm sure nobody does that. So, I've been really into this book. Mainly the series in general. The second, I don't want to spoil too much for my next review, but Volume 2 is probably like my favorite Mignola book ever. So, and honestly, yeah. this is written by Mike Mignola and Ben Stenbeck. Basically, how do I explain this? Throughout all of the Mignola-verse books, they kind of reference Sir Edward Grey. He's in the service of the queen, and that's how you get the title Sir, because no motherfucker just walking around on the streets in motherfucking New York with their all britches all high up motherfucking shit going into fucking Nordstrom Rack. Queen Victoria don't like that shit. That ain't fucking Sir material. Queen Victoria likes Victoria's Secret. I think Queen Victoria's the queen in this. I'm not totally sure, honestly. What the fuck is he saying? Yeah, anyways, he fights monsters and shit, but it's a bit more than that. That's like bizarrely oversimplified. You'll notice that that's the description for many Mignola-verse books, but I feel Sir Edward Grey stands out amongst all like the hard-boiled detective figures in all of this for reasons I'm about to unveil to you. Let's see. So, writing. Let's talk about some writing here. So, one of my favorite parts about this, and I should explain, that I am a big film buff, and as required for a film buff, you must be a huge fan of film noir. And this book actually takes all of the tropes from film noir, which, if you don't know, that is the detective film spanning between 1920 to 1940-ish. That's about a guesstimate of where the range is. What the fuck was I saying? Oh, yeah. And it uses all those tropes, but adapts them into an 1880s England setting, which is just something that film noir never really covered. And it does it quite awesomely. While it takes some of the tropes, ditches some of the other ones. The biggest trope that's missing from this is actually the missing femme fatale, which, if you've ever seen a film noir, it's basically the really hot girl who comes on the screen and manipulates the main character, and she's the bad guy and stuff like that. If you've ever seen Who Framed Roger Rabbit, Jessica Rabbit is a prime example of a femme fatale, even though she's not the bad guy in that, but the point of her is that, you know, she has all the other qualities of it. And, that's pretty much why I really like this book. One of the cool things it does is, it changes. Film noir was a reaction to World War II, basically. That's oversimplifying. There are many, many, many ways to interpret film noir, but one of the bigger ones is that it's sort of a reaction to World War II, changing social roles. Women were now filling the places of all the missing men in World War II. So there's this sort of like evil reaction towards women stealing the male social role. That's what the idea of where the femme fatale comes from and stuff like that. And this changes it into a reaction to the Industrial Revolution. It's kind of hard to show, but like, basically, so Sir Edward Grey's cobra in this is the Heliopic Brotherhood of Ra. They're kind of referenced a lot throughout the Mignola-verse, and that's his major thing. And basically, they're like a cult that collects like fucking mummies and shit. But their thing is that they like science! Dun 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 dun! I kind of did that wrong, but whatever. And and that contrasts heavily with what Sir Edward Grey is, because he comes from like the fucking, I don't know England very well, but he kind of comes from, he was the son of a game warden. He's super Catholic, and he's kind of put into this world where Christianity, not even just Christianity, but like everything sort of, I don't want to offend any religious people. I just want to, but in everybody's eyes in this book, they consider Christianity sort of like a superstition, right? Which is very weird because like at this time period, you'd think that, you'd think that just everybody's fucking Catholic, which is probably true, but in terms of the book, he happens to be centered in a place that's very, like, it's very pro-science. And so it's very interesting that they kind of took this very Catholic character and, made it sort of a fish-out-of-water story, which is basically what a film noir is, just a really dark fish-out-of-water story. That's kind of one of the cool things I liked about it. And even though I don't consider myself a Catholic, or I don't want to say religious, because I consider atheism a religion, and I think saying I'm not religious is kind of stupid, but you get what I mean. I used to be very Catholic, and I'm not saying that like I went to church with my mom and stuff. Like, I legitimately, like, was really Catholic, and I just changed. It's very important to me, so it's kind of cool seeing a book nowadays that doesn't take a Catholic character and makes them like a fucking evil sociopath, because most Catholics are actually pretty cool people, and Sir Edward Grey is a very cool person. So yeah, and that's kind of one of the cool things I find about the Mignola-Verse. I'm talking about that as if, like, everything fucking hates Catholicism. But, like, when you get into, like, the things that hipsters read, it's usually very, like, anti-establishment, man. So, you know, it's not fucking, what's one, like, ABC? Was ABC originally the religious channel? I don't fucking know. I don't care. But, yeah. Let's see. The Fish Out of Water story. I got my little list here because I recorded this once and it was awful. So, no femme fatale. Oh, yeah. So, I wanted to go over what my favorite scene in this book is. Let me flip to it. So, Sir Edward and this girl, Mary... they're getting drinks and they're hitting on each other because one has a penis, one has a vagina. That's their thing. They're super into that. They're like flopping the ween into the vavoine. The vavoine is what I'm calling it. And, so it basically kind of sets up his, like, every noir character has like their tragic backstory sort of thing going on, right? And this, this isn't really necessarily tragic. But it kind of is. Basically, they draw the comparison. When rumors start circulating about Sir Edward, he gets the name Witchfinder coined in a newspaper. And Witchfinder is a reference to, well, in this book, it's a character called Henry Hood, who back in a million years ago, or like 200 years ago, same thing, was responsible for hanging like 300 women for being witches. I'm not finished with the Hellboy universe, so this might have been covered in another book. But here it describes that this character's rumored to be plaguing the earth because he got, like, destroyed by Satan and stuff. And so this book starts to deal with this idea of predestination, right? That Sir Edward's sort of bound by his fate to be cast into oblivion or whatever. Which is something that's brought up earlier because a medium tells Sir Edward that he's being stalked by a black hooded figure with the words Karen written on his head. Which is a reference. I won't spoil what that is, but fucking the Mignola-Verse, just if you've read Hellboy in Hell, you know what it is. The theme running through this is that he's sort of dealing with fate. And his fate actually ends up coming true. Which is one of the reasons why this character, I guess this is kind of spoiling things, but he tends to really like Hellboy, in the afterlife. I'll just put it that way, I guess, if that makes any sense. Because Hellboy is one of the few characters in this who's able to he defies his own fate. He's supposed to take over hell. But he doesn't. He's a good guy. And that's why he's sort of like a glimmer of hope for Sir Edward. And he's able to kind of put a positive spin on his quote-unquote demise, but it's not really a demise, if you know. But, and so that dialogue scene really sets that up really well. And you kind of get this idea of where the story's going. And that sets up basically the rest of the whole thing. And one of the cool things about Witchfinder is that it works well as its own book. You don't really have to know much about any of the other Mignola-verse books or Hellboy universe now that Mignola is kind of stepping down, but you get what I mean. And that's one of the things I praise this book for. Let's see. Artwork. Ben Stenbeck. Ben Stenbeck's fucking awesome. You can actually, I looked him up, and if you go on his website, he actually has his very first comic book, not his first comic book, but like his first pitched book up on his website for free that kind of got him his job. I suggest you read it. It's really good. It doesn't even have much dialogue in it. It's just a lot of really cool artwork. And his art's very similar to Mike Mignola's, but very different. He uses a lot of chiaroscuro sort of stuff, just like Mike Mignola. That's more of a film term, but chiaroscuro basically, I always compare this stuff to film, so if you get confused, I'll explain it. Chiaroscuro is the interplay of dark and light, which is something that Mike Mignola uses. That's very noir. It's like, it's straight up noir. That's actually a term that's associated with noir. So there's heavy shadows, stuff like that. And also, I gotta bookmark this page because I gotta show you something in a second. Yeah, and I'm a huge fan of his art, actually. I actually like it better than Mignola's, honestly. I will be perfectly honest, because there's a lot more detail to it. I think the line work works a bit better. I will say the one thing that annoys me about this book, I did the math. Sir Edward's supposed to be 23, and then by the end of, since every book's 1 year, by the end of 4, that means he's 26. So, he don't look fucking 23. I'm turning 22, and I don't look anything like fucking Sir Edward. Which for a day, this drew me insane, because I kept like doing the math over, like, am I doing this right? So for like a day, I like went insane, like, this can't be correct. And now it doesn't bother me, but like, it's sort of this thing. Imagine like, you're like fucking Indiana, like you're like 10 and you like Indiana Jones. And you're like, yeah, I wanna grow up to be just like Indiana Jones. I wanna go on adventures, and I'm gonna be smart, and I'm gonna have a whip. And then you find, you're like, what? I wonder how old he is. You look it up, and he's like 11. And you're just like, oh my god, no, what am I done with my life? You like, you know, you're like, shit, that's wrong. Does not compute. Beep, boop, bop. And it's the same case for me, because I'm basically 10. And I was reading this like, oh gosh, I want to be, this guy's so cool. I want to express myself by wanting to be this character. And I looked up his life level, aka his age. And I was like, shit, no. I have a year to become fucking this badass fucking witch finder. Fuck. I better get working. So yeah, that sucked. But I don't actually care. So yeah, that's really cool. I'm not trying to spoil too much. You also notice, if you've read BPRD, you'll notice some characters that show up in here that you'd probably recognize. But, you know, you don't need to have read anything else, really. Maybe just like a little introduction to the style of the Mignola-verse, that it's Lovecraftian horror, would help. But, yeah. That's cool. But, yeah, and I also wanted to say that I think the character of Sir Edward really stands out, because there's a lot of, I already said this, but there's a lot of these, like, hard-boiled detective types in the Mignola-verse. And some of them kind of blend together a little bit, but not really. They all at least have their own distinct stuff, but I think Sir Edward really stands out, even though his artwork looks very similar to a lot of the other books, his character is very different. One of the cool things about him is that, like, in book 3, there's this really cool moment where he's basically dying, and then he also, the guy, the bad guy in the scene is also dying, and they're just sitting next to each other, and he's like, ha ha ha, you're about to die, and he's like, well, okay. I mean, like, I've literally had a medium tell me that all these angels are fucking, like, bros with me, so I really have nothing to worry about. I'm super cool with going to heaven. And that's kind of the thing. He's like super, he has nothing to fear other than like the things that he grows attached to in this book. And that really spawns some cool dynamics with his character. Especially if you know how this fucking book ends up. Because the only way you can really kill Sir Edward, let's put it this way, without spoiling anything, the only way you can really kill Sir Edward, somebody who's not afraid of dying, is to remove the possibility of him ever being able to go to heaven, despite all of his attempts. That's the only way you could have a depressing ending for this book. So yeah. Now, one thing I wanted to bring up, so while I'm on this page, let's flip this over. Actually, let me also find... So, all right, these guys right here. You recognize them? You recognize those fuckers? You better fucking recognize them, because let's try to do this. I'm gonna lose the page, aren't I? I lost the page. I believe it is this one. Gotta remove it from its plastic. This is interesting. I hope you're having a good time. Da 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 da. Hellboy in Hell, issue 6. I mean, this isn't a particularly... There's a slightly better. But, like, look at them! Same guys, motherfucker! Same fuckers. And then, if you look at... Let's get a better picture here. Here. So, if you look at the layout of Hell, this is what Hell looks like in the Mignola-Verse. It's a labyrinth of buildings that you walk through and you, like, never find your way out of. Even though they somehow know what the edge of Hell looks like. It's confusing. Some people know have a map of Hell, some people don't. And then, if you go back here... You know, you can see the very clear comparisons. They're trying to draw in this book. This is definitely doing some Hellboy Hell stuff, which I think I'm 99% certain that this book came out in 2008. Whereas this volume came out, or this issue came out in 2014, but when did those characters appear? I don't have any earlier issues of Hellboy in Hell. Those characters do appear earlier in this, so... I think they probably came out around the same time as this book came out. But yeah. And also one cool thing about this book, I guess not cool, but they totally end this in a way where they think they're never gonna have a sequel to this book. So they pretty much just tell you, and then this stuff happened, the end. And then the next issue, it starts up again, and you're like, oh shit. That's cool. I don't know, I just thought the way it ended was kind of funny, knowing that there's future books. Also, one thing I wanted to point out is that this wasn't really part of the Witchfinder stuff. This actually came out before Witchfinder, but this is just a one-off issue they did about Henry Hood, who I actually thought Henry Hood, because I was confusing him with the real-life guy, I was like, wait, is that a real guy? But... His character is directly based off of... I can't remember his name, but he's basically the same person as this other guy, just with a different name. This real-life guy who called himself the Witchfinder General, killed, like, over 300 people in a year for being witches. Not a nice guy. But yeah, also they got the nice artwork back here and stuff. I love... Well, where is it? Come on. I love this early artwork where it says, "Why the long face?" I don't know why, I found that just really nice. So yeah, Witchfinder. Really fucking like this book. Next up, I'll be reviewing Lost and Gone Forever, and then I'll be done with the Witchfinder stuff. Maybe after that, I'll move on to like Hellboy and the BPRD or something. I don't really know. But yeah, I'm super excited to continue this series. Let me know if there's anything you want me to do extra when reviewing these books. I don't fucking know. Also, whenever a new book is finished, like, let's see, I think there's two issues left of The Visitor, How and Why He Stayed, so I'll review that. I'm not collecting Lobster Johnson right now, I'm gonna collect those in trade. So whenever that goes up in trade, I'll review that. I should do Rise of the Black Flame. I should review that really quick because I just reread that, and that'll be fun. So yeah, good stuff. Goodbye.